keynote speaker this afternoon is one of only two people outside of the United States of America to be inducted into the Speaker's Hall of Fame. She not only talks about joy, she brings it into the room. Would you please welcome the remarkable Amanda Gore? Okay, stop, cut the music, quick. We haven't got much time. I want you to make sure that you're sitting next to someone else. If you've got more than two seats between you and someone else, you have to move, otherwise you're going to die. So, on the count of three, I want you to grab the shoulders of the person next to you, even if you've not spoken to them all day long, and I want you to shake them like this and go, wake up, this really matters, and then go the other side. One, two, three, go. Wake up, this really matters. Now the other side, wake up. Now that you two, what's the matter with you? Two blokes, now go to the bloke behind you. We haven't got time for this. Now, the problem is, can we have full house lights? That we are living lives of habits and patterns ruled unconsciously by fear. And most of us don't realize it because it's unconscious. We're ruled by this fear. And so just repeat after me so we get it embedded in us. We are living lives of habits and patterns ruled unconsciously by fear. Excellent. And you know, the Harvard Business Review, we're here talking about happiness and the corporate world. Do you know that I was just in the States last month, and maybe it was only a week ago. Anyway, I was there. And the latest Harvard Business Review has got a big yellow smiley face on the front of it, talking about the importance of happiness at work and how it increases profitability, productivity, creativity, innovation, and everything. It's like, duh. But now it's in the Harvard Business Review. Excellent. And then the other critical thing that we need to be thinking about is that there is a very big difference between happiness and joy. And I can describe it a bit like this, because we're looking for joy in all the wrong places. And it's like this. We're all running down endless pitch black corridors, desperately looking for light switches. And we're all like, oh, we're going through life. And all the darkness is the fear. And suddenly we feel a light switch somewhere. And we flick it on and we go, oh, I'm happy because the fear's gone. But the trouble is, it doesn't last long, because something will happen to the light bulb. It'll break, or the thingy in the middle will go, the filament thingy, or the power will be cut off. And all of a sudden, we're in the darkness of fear again. Until we stop and we look inside and we really pay attention and we wake up, we're not going to see that there's an amazing light right inside us. In fact, it's the most extraordinary light. You could light up the whole world with this, and that light inside will eradicate your fear forever. That's your joy. So, on the count of three, I want you to look at your new best friend that you've touched already a few times today, and don't sit by yourself and do this, all right, any of you around there. I want you to look at him and go, you are an astonishing being of light. You are an astonishing... Ready? One, two, three, go. You are an astonishing being of light. You are an astonishing being of light. Beautiful. Now, try to look like it as well, will you? Some of you are going, you are an astonishing being of light. You are an astonishing... And all you're worried about is you. You think, oh, I feel stupid. Anyway, you're not a light. Yes, they are. Sometimes people just don't realize it as much. And our job is to help them brighten up. And that's what the Joy Project is about. The Joy Project's mission is to eradicate fear and to help people understand that they truly are enormous, astonishing beings of light. And that comes from Daniel Ladinsky's poem in I Heard God Laughing. It's another Hafez poem. And it's just beautiful. You want to get I Heard God Laughing. It's a beautiful book. I don't do poetry. I'm not that smart, but I love this book. And it's all Hafez's stuff. And he does talk about us being astonishing beings of light that in fact give the sun its brightness. And when you start to look at the beauty of all the things that have been written, and you start to realize that everyone around you is beautiful, even their warts are beautiful, then we start to embrace the philosophy of the Joy Project, which is going to be a global movement where we have people coming in and creating joy tribes. So I wrote this book with my mum one's help. And the book is currently called The Gospel of Joy, but we're changing that to The 12 Stepping Stones to Joy, because everybody thinks Gospel of Joy. Oh, no, we don't want that book. So we're calling it 12 Stepping Stones to Joy, okay? So buy it. It'll be the same book. So, and if you see Gospel of Joy, you'll get it cheap, okay? So now, all of you, I want you to just jump up and down in your seat. It's a little bit difficult, I know, but at least I'm not making you stand up. So I want you just to jump a little bit up and down your seat. Try not to look annoyed, all right? It's very good. I've never seen a room vibrate like this before. You're not jumping much, sir. That's better. Okay, now you can stop. Okay, that was the little jumping stepping stones. You jumping from one stepping stone to another. Now, the first one and the most essential one is gratitude. You cannot go further along the line and the path to joy until you have passed gratitude. So I'm going to give you symbols tonight. We haven't got very long for all these things so you can remember them. So everybody go like this. Quick, quick, even up there. Quick. Now go like this. These are your gratitude glasses. Okay, now keep them on, keep them on. You don't have to write this down, you'll remember it. Now keep them on. These will change your life. On the count of three, you're going to look at your new best friend and you are going to say, wait till I count to three though, okay? You're going to say, I am so grateful for you. I am so grateful for you. Ready? One, two, three, go. I am so grateful for you. I am so grateful for you. Beautiful, beautiful. Now, you don't clap, we haven't got time. Now, the important thing is that these are free. You can take them anywhere. You can be in the car, and you've got a choice. You can be wallowing in the darkness of fear or anger, looking at someone else at a red light, go, you sucker. Stop. Look at each other and go, stop it. Go, quick, stop it. Stop it. Instead, you are going to put on your gratitude glasses while you're sitting there at the red light, like this, and you're going to look at the person in the car on either side. And whether you're listening to the girls on radio or not, you can actually start laughing. Who cares about the other person? Lock the doors just in case, okay? Now, the other thing is that people often get twitchy. You know, they go, oh, but that's silly. You know, it's like, well, okay. Who cares if it's silly? That is the basis of becoming smarter. You release dendrites when you're silly. Did you know that? Neurons. In the brain, there are neurons. One comes here, one comes here. It's part of neuroscience. And anytime you do something silly, dendrites come out. And that's how the neurons talk to each other. Oh, let's do it. Everybody go like this. But don't look like you've got a wounded wing. Go like this, quick. On the count of three, you're going to look silly. You're going to do something silly. Look at your new best friend and go, dendrites. Dendrites, ready? One, two, three, go. Dendrites. Dendrites. See, now you are more joyful because we know joy is the precursor to success. See, people go, oh, you will all be happy when I'm successful. No, it's the other way around. Joy is the precursor to success. And if you're willing to do silly things, you literally become smarter. Stress makes you, look, stress puts on abdominal fat. It eats brain cells, so, and it makes you sick. So if you're going to stress, you're going to make yourself fat, sick, and stupid. Why? Don't do it. Whereas on the other hand, joy makes you thin, creative, and smart. So, which one will I do? So let's get silly. Now, if you don't want to use your fingers, get a set of these. Wear them at work. See, people look at me and they go, ah, she's funny, she's joking. No. When you wear these at work, even if it's with customers, what do you think they're going to do? You think they're going to look at you and go, well, you look stupid. No, they're going to look at you and go, nice glasses. And you say, yeah, they're my gratitude glasses. I am very grateful for you and your business. Come on in. You know, you need someone to bring a bit of joy into your life. If you don't want to wear them on your eyes, wear them on your head. And if that doesn't work, put them on here. You're having a staff meeting, put them in there. And somebody starts to go, but say nothing. Slide these across the table and say, would you like to tell us why you're grateful you've got a job? Hello? Wait, don't clap, we haven't got time. Now here's the other thing. You see, it's impossible to have a heart full of misery and a heart full of gratitude at the same time. It is impossible to have a heart full of misery and a heart full of gratitude at the same time. Get grateful. It stops depression. It helps you sleep better. And how do we teach our children to be grateful? We look at them and say thank you to your brother. I said, say thank you. Say thank you to your brother. I don't think this is teaching the kids gratitude. Get a set of these and every night round the table, you put them on. Don't even wait for these, because otherwise you're going to go, oh, we didn't do it because we didn't have the glasses. Just use these, all right? It doesn't matter what age they are. Get them to put the glasses on and talk about things for which they're grateful during the day. It's brilliant. So, the very first stepping stone, jiggle up and down your seat for a second. First stepping stone is gratitude. Excellent. So, we get your gratitude glasses on. Now, the second stepping stone is generosity. And you know, there's a woman called the Mother who used to study with Sri Aurobindo, and she wrote in one of her amazing books, everything always depends on the way in which things are done. Not so much what one does, but the spirit in which one does it. Is that true? Everything always depends. I mean, how many of us are in relationships and we don't want to do something, but we do it because we have to compromise. So we say, we'll do it. But on the inside, our spirit is, you are going to pay. I will do this, but you're going to pay. Now, the bottom line is that everybody has light inside. What do you call those things in a kitchen with gas? Stove, yeah, thanks, stove. So, you know how you got a stove? Well, a gas stove's got a pilot light. And you can turn a switch one way and that pilot light goes woomph and ignites into flame. You turn it the other way and it just dies. Well, every person you meet, every single person you meet for the rest of your life and up to this point in your life has got a pilot light inside their hearts. That's their spirit. And every one of us every day makes a choice to either look at someone else and ignite their spirit or to do this to them. And I call these people spirit foofers, okay? Now, do not be a foofer. You do not want to be a foofer. So on the count of three, one side, then the other, you're going to say, but look, wait till I count to three, and look like this, okay? I want you to go, I'm a spirit igniter, not a foofer. Don't look at someone next to you and go, I can't believe we're doing this, can you? Like, I should have gone. I knew I should have left. It's just ridiculous. This is so awful. Stop it. Just stop it, okay? So on the count of three, remember, you are lighting the spirit of the person next to you. You're helping them become that incandescent light that will illuminate the world if they see how beautiful they really are. If you look at them, or by the way, if you're sitting next to someone who looks at you and go, I'm spirit igniter, not a fufu. Help them, because no one wakes up in the morning and goes, how many spirits can I foof today? No one does that. They are unconscious. Just like they're unconscious of fear, they are unconscious that they're foofers. And help them. So if they look at you and they go, I'm three and a half. Look at them and go like this. Okay? So ready, on the count of three, I'm a spirit igniter, not a foofer. And look like this, okay? One, two, three, go. I'm a spirit igniter, not a foofer. I'm a spirit igniter, not a foofer. Beautiful, good job, guys. So be generous with your spirit. Go forth and ignite people's spirits. It's not very hard to do, and it is a beautiful gift for everyone you meet. So the next stepping stone we've got a lot to go through. We're going to dance between the stepping stones to joy, right? The next one is hope. What do we say to ourselves most of the time when we get hopeless? It's hopeless. Everything is dark. We're in this dark corridor, and I can't see how I'm going to die. Stop it. Stop it. We have got to turn things around. You know, in America, they did a big study, as they do in America, with 1,000 people who are very successful. And they examined why, and they defined success in a very broad sense, but it was a good definition. And they looked at these people to find a common denominator. It was not socioeconomic status like they thought. It was not education. It was not parental background. None of those. They had to invent a term for these people. And the term they came up with was that they were good finders. Everywhere they went, they found good. They found good in the people they met. They found good in the situations that they encountered and they found themselves in. Find good. Be a good finder. So, on the count of three, one side. Aren't you feeling bonded now? That's great. On the count of three, you're going to look one side, then the other, say, I am a good finder. I am a good finder. Go. One, two, three. I am a good finder. I am a good finder. And you know, be the good finder at work. The good finder at work is the one who's the spirit igniter. The one who walks around going, it all sucks, everything's gonna suck, it always does suck. These are the sort of people you want to get rid of as quickly as possible. Send to the competition. Send them as far away as you can. Because all they do is suck everybody's energy down. Isn't that true? And the other thing, DeWitt Jones has got a... Oh, by the way, we got a website, www.thejoyproject.com. Go to the Joy Project website and look at the resources we've got, because DeWitt Jones has created a most magnificent video. He's a fabulous photographer that I knew in the States. And it's called Celebrate What's Right. Celebrate what's right in your life. You know, we meet somebody that becomes our partner in life. And for the first couple of years, it's like, oh, I'm so blessed. It's so wonderful. I've got the most wonderful. I'm so in love. It's so perfect. 2 years go by. Oh, look at that wart. Ew, God, that irritates me. You are so annoying. Oh, there's another wart. And by the time 3 or 4 years have gone by, you are just one giant wart. I don't know what I saw in you. They are exactly the same person, but what are we focusing on? The warts. We're not celebrating what's right with them. So, count to three, one side, then the other. I am going to celebrate what's right with everyone. I am going to celebrate what's right with everyone. Go, go, 1, 2, 3. I am going to celebrate what's right with everyone. I am going to celebrate what's right with everyone. And so hope is another stepping stone. But, you know, just to put all this in the context of the corporate world, 22nd century leadership is actually a mashup of about four sciences. The first is neuroscience, which you've heard a little bit about. We haven't got time to go into this, so just be impressed by the big birds. And words, not birds. And this is epigenetics, which is all about beliefs. And this is emotional intelligence. And this one is positive psychology. Now, this is the secret part. In the sweet spot in the middle, this is where amazing leadership occurs. Well, I was in America, you know, like I said recently, and you know how pretty conservative really over there. And I said to one of my ultra conservative friends, I said, Mark, I don't know what to call this sweet spot in the middle where this brilliant leadership occurs. And he said, well, your name's Gore. What about the G spot? So what have you done with my conservative friend? So we're not calling it that. Instead, we are calling it the joy spot. Okay? Because this is where great leadership occurs, when you can create a fear-free, joy-filled workplace. So your mission, should you choose to accept it, is to become a walking joy spot. Okay? So count to three, one side, then the other. I am a walking joy spot. I am a walking joy spot. 1, 2, 3, go. You two are playing together, aren't you? It's very good. Ma'am, I hope you're playing with somebody over there. Now, of course, the other critical thing is, if you look at the word joy, if you look at the word joy, just open your heart. If you open your heart and you connect to the divine and you serve others, you will find joy. You will be living in joy, and the light that is inside you will radiate out, and you will become a beacon for others in the world. So, it's time to jiggle up and down. We haven't got time. Don't clap. I know it's beautiful, but we haven't got time. So, jiggle up and down. Time to jiggle again. Because the next thing we're talking about is, starts with F. What is it? Forgiveness. Yes, it's forgiveness. And don't worry about how it looks. So, this is a gift from my mum to you. My mum and stepdad were married for about 20 years. And by the way, do you know what the number one predictor of heart attack is? Quick, number one predictor. Stress. No, you'll never guess, I'll tell you. It's anger and hostility. Okay? Now, what do you think the antidote to anger and hostility is? It's forgiveness, very good. And if you look at the word forgiving, it stands for giving. See, if you're going to forgive someone, you have to give them love. So, my mum's stepdad married 20 years, he dies, she's devastated. And I have two stepbrothers, one of whom is fabulous, and the other, tremendous opportunity for practicing forgiveness. Which I've done now, and we get on just fine. But at the time, wasn't so good. Anyway, so things happened, and now my mum is depressed and angry and staying with me for 6 weeks. So, and I knew we had to do something because it isn't at a period of intense stress that people get sick. It's 18 months to 2 years after this intense period of stress that people get rheumatoid arthritis, multiple sclerosis, heart attack. So I knew if we didn't do something, she would get cancer, but I didn't know what to do. So I go to New Zealand. I meet a cardio-psycho-neuro-immunologist. Did you get that? Cardio the heart, psycho the emotions, neuro the nervous system, immunology the immune system. Anyway, Paul Pearsall, fabulous guy. He teaches me that when we send love to other people, not only do we boost our immune system, but we boost theirs. It's cosmic. It's amazing. And it's true. So I go home. Mum's staying with me, right? And I go home and I say, Mum, I've got the answer. Now, she's used to me. So she says, what do you mean the answer? I said, Mum, you just got to send love. And she said, what do you mean send love? I don't know, Mum, just send love, because I didn't know. So we didn't talk about it anymore. Well, 2 weeks later, it's time for me to take her to the airport to go home. I come back to my place and I find a note on my pillow. And in this note, if you haven't done one like this for someone you love recently, oh, there you go, do it soon. I don't need it, thank you. At the very bottom of this note, she'd drawn a great big heart on one side, a great big heart on the other, and a whole lot of little hearts in between. That was my mum's way of sending me love. Now, each little heart is a zoot, right? Z-O-O-T. Now, everybody make your hands go like this. Put your hands over your heart. On the count of three, you are going to say zoot, 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 and touch your new best friend's chest just above their hearts, okay? Right, here we go. One, two, three, both sides. Zoot, 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 zoot. Zoot, 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 zoot. See? How beautiful. Now, did you two touch each other? Yeah, good job. Now, I want you to go forth and zoot. Teach your children to zoot. Do as much as you can to bring zooting into your life. In fact, on YouTube, one of my videos, I got this little clip on zooting with more detail. It's gone viral. Like, I think it's 200,000 people have seen it now, which is a lot in Australia, not in the world. But anyway, so zoot. Now, jiggle. Stepping stone, next one coming, good, great. Next stepping stone, love. Now think about it, where do we learn to give love? What? If you think about it, we learn to give love from our parents. Two of us come together in a relationship and we think we love each other. We think we know how to give love because we never think about how we give love. We just assume we know how to do it. And in the early days of a relationship, it doesn't matter. Whatever you do is fabulous. But you know, when you get to the wart stage, it starts to matter. And I've done things that have driven men nuts because, but at the same time, I'm thinking, oh, you're so lucky. Oh, what a great thing to do. Oh, wait till he opens his briefcase in the meeting and all those little hearts fall out. He nearly killed me. So what we need to do is to ask people how they want to be loved. Now, watch how you do it. You've got to watch the nonverbals. What do I do that makes you feel that I love you? Okay, watch. What do I do that makes you feel that I love you? What did I say? I can give a rat's ass about you. Me, I care about. See, the nonverbals matter. Watch this one. What do I do that makes you feel that I love you? You're bleeding from the head injuries that have come, okay? So let's all do it together. Ready? Let's do it together. What do I do, very gentle hand movements, that make you feel that I love you? Now we're going to do it once again so that the men who are doing this actually smile. Because the guys are going, what do I do, bitch, that makes you feel that I love you? Now, and what's more, when someone answers you, you have to do what they say, okay? You cannot go, no. When I met you, I did not hug. You know that? So, no, I'm not going to hug. Don't ask them if you're not going to do what they say. And please ask your children. So here we go. Look happy. Look joyful. What do I do that makes you feel that I love you? Beautiful, beautiful. Okay, last one. And I know I'm going to go a little bit over time. Is laugh. It's really important that we laugh. There is no joy fairy. There is no joy fairy that looks at you and goes, ooh, you look miserable down there. Bonk, have some fun with the magic. What doesn't happen? You've got to be your own joy fairy. And look, you're going to love this. Look at my symbol for the joy fairy. Ta-da! Wait, it gets better. These are essential parenting and leadership items. You have got to have one of these, put it in a holster. I want you to walk around, and whenever you want to spread joy, you whip out your wand, this one, and you go, good job. Celebrate what's right. Use it on yourself. When things are a bit tense, make your teenagers invisible. You're invisible. So quick, everybody hold up your own pretend magic wand. Quick. On the count of three, one side, then the other. Bring, I'm a joy fairy, and look like one. One, two, three, go. Bring, I'm a joy fairy. Bring, I'm a joy fairy. Beautiful. Now, everybody stand up, stand up, stand up. And help us create a global joy movement, okay? So I want you to put an arm around each other, which means you have to shimmy across the aisle. Shimmy, 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 guys. Because when you connect to the divine who is standing next to you, what? There is not a good divine gap. Go, come over. Move your feet. Move your feet so you shimmy together to be one divine, cosmic, amazing light group. Some of you have to move over like that. And now, look at the person next to you again with the biggest smile you can possibly imagine and tell them again what an astonishing being of light they are. Go. You are an astonishing being of light. You are an astonishing being of light. Joy. Stay together, stay together. Keep holding each other. Join our joy movement so that we can, it gives you the tools to become aware of your light, to brighten your light, and to go forth and light up everyone else or help them see their own light. So we're going to finish off with a joy song, and we're going to dance. We're going to do a little joy jig as we do this, okay? So, keep hanging on to each other. You've got to connect to the divine, and the serving others is bringing out their light. So stay hanging on. The words you are going to be singing are always look on the bright side of life. Da-da, da-da. Always look on the bright side of life. So you ready? Let's have the music. Thank you. Listen to the words. Louder.
Some things in life are bad. They can really make you mad. Other things just make you swear and curse.
Oh, darn.
When you're chewing on life's gristle,
Dad, grumble, give a whistle. And this'll help things turn out for the best. Now get ready as one.
Always look on the bright side of life.
Try to look happy.
Always look on the bright side of life.
Shine your light wherever you can.
Life is jolly rotten.
There's something you've forgotten. And that's to laugh and smile and dance and sing. When you're feeling in the dumps, don't be silly chumps. Just purse your lips and whistle. That's the thing. Get ready, get ready.
Always look on the bright side of life.
Sing this every morning.
Always look on the bright side of life.
Keep jumping, dancing between the stepping stones.
For life is
quite absurd. And death's the final word. You must always face the curtain with a bang. Ta-da! Forget about your sin.
Give the audience a grin.
Enjoy it. It's your last chance anyhow. Different words.
Always look on the bright side of death.
Do-do. Different words, different words.
Just before you draw your terminal breath.
We haven't got long. Be joyful now.
Life's a piece of shit
when you look at it. Life's a laugh and death's a joke, it's true.
You'll see it's all a show.
Keep them laughing as you go. Just remember that the last laugh is on you. Last chance, go.
Always look bright side of life.
Do-do, 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 do-do.
Always look on the bright side of life.
It's a magic wand for a fun fairy. Look out.
Always look on the bright side of life.
Do-do. These are joysters. Joysters, little joy buddies. Make joy tribes. Together, joy buddies in a joy tribe.
I mean, what you got to lose? You know, you come from
look out, don't look up, don't look up.